Georgia State football is back from Wisconsin, and men's soccer's off to a 4-3 start. Hi again, Panther fans, and welcome into this week's Georgia State Sports Update. Joining us in studio in our first segment here on the Georgia State Sports Update, Brett Cerency, the head coach of men's soccer. Brett, great to have you in here. You guys are off to a pretty good start, 4-3 after a season-opening loss to Mercer. You guys have scored some goals, and you're still undefeated at home, playing well right now.
We did. We had a nice string of three games where I think we scored 11 goals against some good competition. So, you know, we're always making a point to defend Panthersville, and so far we've done that really successfully.
Well, again, it was a season-opening loss to Mercer, 1-0, and obviously tough time scoring, but then all of a sudden the offense really just kicked in. You score four goals and a win over Memphis, four goals and a win over Lipscomb, and then a 3-1 win over Central Arkansas. It's all of a sudden like from game one to game two and then three and four, the light went on offensively.
Yeah, you know, I really think we needed the game against Mercer to kind of get ourselves back on track. We only played one exhibition game this year, and I think that had a lot to do with the ultimately not a great performance against Mercer. But, yeah, the guys came back. We came back home and created a lot of chances, and we're fortunate to put some away. And it was a nice little three-game win streak after the initial loss.
9-8-1 last year and advancing to the Sun Belt Conference Championship game. So you take all of that momentum into the offseason. What was the offseason like for you and the squad getting ready for this year?
Yeah, well, we had a lot of guys returning, so that was huge. I think sometimes you worry about complacency, but we had a lot of young kids, you know, 5-6 freshmen last year that played considerable minutes for us. So those guys coming into their sophomore year, a little bit more experience, knowing what to expect, and I give a ton of credit to those guys in terms of what they did in the spring and over the summer, and they prepared themselves, and they came back ready to go this fall. So hopefully we can keep that going.
Yeah, you know what they always say about freshmen, and you hear coaches say this all the time, the greatest thing is they're going to become a sophomore. So everybody that was on that team last year that had that experience of playing in the Sun Belt Championship game, they take that with them into this year. And sometimes you got to go through it that one time and carry that experience with you in order to get it right, hopefully, the next time, which will hopefully be this year.
100%. And, you know, it was something to where, like you said, to be in that position for the first time, it was huge for us. Obviously, we would have loved to have won it, but, I think it's something moving forward that will definitely prepare us for once we get into postseason, and hopefully those experiences will pay dividends this year.
So you had Memphis at home after Mercer in the second game. Memphis out of American Athletic Conference, and great job by you guys offensively to be able to put that thing to get the offense in gear and bounce back after a tough loss like that.
You know, I give the guys a ton of credit for it. There was a lot of accountability after the Friday game, and a lot of guys looking in the mirror and just saying I wasn't good enough. And
right. The
way that they were able to turn around quickly, because we only had about a 36-hour rest by the time we got home from Mercer, we came out flying, and we played a lot of numbers that day. It was very hot, so the way the guys came together collectively and were able to put that performance in was huge, and got us, like I said, going off to a little three-game win streak.
And then you come back in the next match, and it's Lipscomb, our old buddies from the old Atlantic Sun, and you drop four on them as well in another 4-1 win.
You know, it was a slow start for us in the first half, but Lipscomb came into the game receiving national votes in the national polls, so we were up for it, and we kind of made some adjustments at halftime, and we were actually down 1-0 at halftime and came out and were able to get the job done. So it was a good win for us, especially on the heels of Memphis, and we were pleased to beat what is now a very good program.
And Central Arkansas runs you to 3-1 on the season at that point because you score three goals in that 3-1 win there. Hannes Burmeister right now leading Georgia State men's soccer, 7 goals and 1 assist. He's got it going.
He's on fire. And the funny thing about him, he hasn't even played the last couple of games. So he's been injured. So, he started off, he's got 2 hat tricks this year and an additional game with a goal. And hopefully that's something that once he gets back healthy, we can continue to build on, because if we're scoring goals, it's going to be tough for us to be beat, I think.
Well, then it's on the road to Providence, Rhode Island, and you lose 2-1 in overtime to Brown, and then you lose 2-0 to Providence. I mean, that's going on the road. I mean, you know, other than Mercer, the first time this team's played away from Atlanta.
And really difficult places to play.
Yeah.
You know, Brown just lost their first game last week, so they're obviously a good team, and playing Providence from the Big East now. You know, great team for us. So, you know, for us, it was, I think last year in those games, we wouldn't have competed the way that we did. Unfortunately, we talk about all the goals that we scored. We created all of those chances. We just weren't able to put the ball in the back of the net. So I think everybody walked away from that weekend disappointed in the results, but confident knowing that moving forward, we'll be able to figure that out.
Let's talk a little bit about your scheduling, because you've got games with UNC Asheville coming up this week, and then you're at South Carolina and at Duke in back-to-back games, and we'll talk about those two games a little bit more. But with Memphis and with Lipscomb, and then taking your team to Providence, I mean, you're getting them ready for Sun Belt play.
100%. And this year, you know, Coastal Carolina joined in the conference. You know, they were top five last year. Georgia Southern with a new coach, App State with a new coach. Hartwick's won 2 years in a row. So, you know, the conference is certainly stepping up, and for us to be able to be prepared for it, we need to play at good competition and against good competition. So we've certainly challenged ourselves with the schedule.
You know, when you mentioned Hartwick, that's the team that you ended up playing and ultimately losing to in the championship. Just tell Panther fans a little bit about Hartwick, because they're really just a member of the Sun Belt as a soccer Division I only. But they're a pretty good men's soccer program.
Correct. Ton of tradition. And the reason why they are, you know, they're Division III and everything else and Division I in soccer, because they have something like 24 Final Fours. So,
yeah.
There's a ton of tradition a few decades ago, but they take a lot of pride in their soccer program. And, yeah, they've come into the Sun Belt for the first 2 years, and they've been able to win it both years. So that's certainly something from our side of things is we want what they have. So we'll be ready next time we play them.
Well, I mentioned that Hannes Burmeister with 7 goals. Max Hemmings has 3. Oliver Haynes has 2 goals. And your freshman, Kyle Clinton, who scored the game winner in the last match. That was his first goal of the season. I mean, you're starting to see who the goal scorers are going to be. I mean, and it's nice to add a freshman like Kyle to that group. Now it just gives you another option to be able to put the ball in the net.
Yeah, and that was Kyle's first start as well, too. So the nice thing about that list you just mentioned is it's 2 sophomores and 2 freshmen. So we've got a lot of young talent mixed in with some experience with some of the older guys, too. And yeah, things are you're coming together. Our aim is, you know, come October 8th when we play Southern, that everything's where it needs to be. So we've got a few weeks before we get to that point.
Sun Belt play, always look into Georgia Southern, right? Whether it's in football, whether it's in men's or women's basketball, baseball, soccer too, the rivalry, you know, ascends and descends throughout every sport here at Georgia State.
100%. It's something that, you know, we've really enjoyed it on the soccer side of things, is the intensity of that rivalry is just gaining more and more steam. And we've been fortunate for the last couple games that we've been able to get the better of them. But they'll be a good program this year, as I mentioned before, with a new coach. And, yeah, you're always looking forward to that game.
All right, I wanted to ask you, you know, last year your team scored 41 goals in 18 matches, which was a little over, you know, 2.5 goals per game, if you want to break it down to the exact number. You know, what was your thought on production last year, and what are you looking for this year? In other words, were you pleased with that number last year?
100%.
I mean, it got you to the championship game.
It did. I think we're a top 5 in the country, actually, in goals scored. So, you know, certainly pleased with that. I think the opposite side of that is that we gave up too many easy goals. So we'd love to be able to score a ton of goals and not give up easy ones, and then I think, you know, we'll be putting ourselves in a good position. But yeah, we've got some good talented attacking players, and hopefully, you know, we can, you know, find our groove as we did with, say, Hannes earlier in the year and put some balls in the back of the net.
All right, real quickly, Yannick Horn, a junior goaltender, 21 saves so far this year. He's allowed 8, and I think he's 3rd in the Sun Belt Conference.
Yannick's coming in great. Yeah, he's, you know, we were very excited about him coming in. He's a transfer from Montevallo. His attitude's phenomenal. He's a great kid. He wants to truly get better. He asks wonderful questions, and we couldn't be happier with him so far.
All right, again, Yannick Horn, Georgia State's goaltender, transfer, playing really well so far. And our Jared Oliver caught up with Yannick as he paid a visit out to the GSU soccer complex.
Montevallo transfer Yannick Horn has made an impact on this team almost instantly. The 6'1 goalkeeper has 21 saves with just 7 games into the season. Yannick's coaches and teammates know they've got a special player inside the net.
Well, my main job is basically to prevent goals, and if I can help my team preventing any chances for the other team, like when they play out or like in their whole process. That's way easier instead of me making any, like 21 or 22 saves, I don't remember the number really. So I try to prevent before actually something happens.
Mainly Yannick's job, as you can see the whole pitch, like if there's a forward to my right, he'll shout right and it will help me out, or shout left. It just helps us out. So anything in behind us, instead of us having to look, we just trust what he says, because as he can see the whole pitch. And we like to joke between the lads, like he's a German, he just never shuts up. So it's good to have him back there always talking. It helps us out a lot.
He's a very good keeper. He works incredibly hard, so everything that you see on the field, he's put that kind of work into it. So he certainly has given us some stability in goal, and I think it gives us a sense of confidence, and the guys in front of him have a bit of confidence as well too, and that certainly helps.
We prepare ourselves the whole week basically for the game. We go through set pieces. I go through my practice during the week. So it's a long time process. Right before a game, I mainly listen to music and try not to stress out myself too much. Maybe not looking too much on my phone, so I get not too much distracted. But besides that, I just try to keep calm and have fun on the field.
He's a very hard worker. You know, it's always good when one of your better players is also one of your harder workers. So he's very hard on himself, and you know, he's critical of his own performances. So you know, he's sitting, you watch film, he listens and he takes things in, and he wants to get better.
Yeah, I've been impressed with him in training. He seems really good. His kicking's really good, and his shot savings. So if he can keep all that up, then I'm sure he'll progress on and do well this season.
Definitely Atlanta or something else in a small town in Alabama. But besides that fact, obviously D1 is way different than D2. It was a goal like for me to play, to compete on the highest level. And I really appreciate that Brett got me here, and I really love it. I'm glad I'm here.
Manning gonna roll out. He's got a man. He's gonna make the throw. It's Robert Davis caught at the 45. Dragged down inside the 40 to the 30. Football got a man across the middle. Almost intercepted by Bobby Baker. And Joe lost the football. Georgia State recovers a fumble. Like it was Bobby Baker. Got time across the middle, it's caught 40-yard, 45-yard line. Glenn Smith, and it looks like it's wide left. It is Bagley. Manning gonna try to lob it up, and it's there, and it's caught. Touchdown, Georgia State. With an eye in the middle. There's a throw across the middle. Intercepted. In and out of the hands of the intended receiver. Rushing. Two steps back. Across the middle, Glenn Smith. Smith still on his feet. 45-40. 35-30. Down the sideline. And he gets tripped up on the far sideline inside the 20. When I walk in a room, she knows she with a goal. I hit a man at the same time. My third leg got hang time.
Again, 23-17, the final score. Wisconsin holds on to beat Georgia State in Madison, Wisconsin. The Panthers now with an off week as they get ready for Sunbelt Conference play. Panthers will head up to lovely Boone, North Carolina, and they'll take on the Appalachian State Mountaineers coming up on the 1st of October. Pleased to be joined in studio right now by the defensive coordinator. That's Jesse Minner. And again, it's one of those tough ball games. You're facing the number 9th-ranked team in the country. And you want to go up there and represent well and bounce back from Air Force, which we did. And then you're kind of thinking afterwards, man, we could have won that game.
Yeah, you know, when you really look at it's disheartening because it's a little bit of a missed opportunity for our program. But very happy with, you know, Coach Miles talked about it leading up to the game. We just needed to do the basic things of football better, block, tackle, make plays in space. So I feel like our guys played hard. We were missing some key pieces, and it gave some young guys an opportunity to get a lot of reps in a great environment against a top 10 team. So I think as the season goes on, that'll benefit us, create more depth. But certainly when at the grand scheme of things, it's a very disheartening loss.
Well, again, we don't want to talk about Air Force, but what a great week of practice going from what happened out in Colorado Springs, which was not a good football game, to the preparation in a relatively short amount of time, because those weeks seem to shrink. It's the same amount of days, but when you're in the middle of getting ready, as you know, you've been doing this a while, the time when you got to leave and then go to Madison comes on you pretty quickly. But again, a great week of practice, and the Panthers were absolutely ready to take that field when we got to Madison.
You know, sometimes it helps to finally get into a normal game week. You know, you had the opener where you have a lot of extra time to prepare. We played on a Friday, so then we had an extra day for Air Force. Sometimes it takes away the pain of the loss because you have to move on so quick. Thought our guys tuned in pretty quick to Wisconsin. We had a good week of preparation. It showed in the way we played, showed in the way we competed. Once again, you know, at the end of the day, you'd like to win that game. But
sure.
But guys are, it's the same thing. You know, we got to prepare well, practice well, do those types of things will give us a chance to play well on Saturdays.
Well, you know, we've talked with Coach Miles the first 2 weeks of this show about, just the number of, the amount of time and the number of plays that your defensive unit had to spend on the field against Ball State and against Air Force, and that's a boatload of plays. It looked like we were going to have a little bit of a repeat of that early on against Wisconsin because I think they had a 7-minute drive and then a 5-minute drive. And we didn't really have the ball much in the first quarter, but again, kudos to the defensive unit because you held them to just the field goals there.
Playing a game like that, and we told the defense Friday night, hey, the game's going to have to be where they're going to move the ball at times.
Yeah.
We're going to have to be stingy in the red zone. We're going to have to get a couple takeaways, which we did. And you're going to have to limit explosive plays. And if we do that, that's going to give us a chance to hang in there. And we told them that the offense was going to pop a couple big plays and talk about our offense. And
right.
So it was a game that really played out the way you hoped. You'd like to make a play or two more there at the end and win the game. But all in all, just happy with the way they stuck to the plan, executed, and put us in a chance to win a game like that.
Well, the first two times, again, that Wisconsin gets in the red zone, and Coach Miles and I had talked both here and on the radio, but just about, you know, you go on the road to play a Big Ten. Obviously, size and speed and mm-hmm. skill. I mean, I'm doing my sheets, and everybody's 6'5", 300, whatever, mm-hmm. 6'6", 300, whatever. Our defense held their ground and kept them out of the end zone in the first two times they got inside the 5-yard line.
It was very good to see, and particularly for us, you know, we're playing some young guys.
I mean,
we had Terry Thomas, a 17, 18-year-old freshman out there.
He's kind of like Shawanye all over again.
Yeah, definitely. And so those guys, you know, somebody's adversity is another person's opportunity. And we had three or four key players out, but it gave those guys a chance to play and they stepped up and like I said, gave us an opportunity to be where we wanted to be.
Yeah, obviously, you'd love to have Shawanye Lawrence and Mackenzie Cheridor and Andrew Everett and Carnell Hobson. They were not available, so as you guys say, next man up, and the next man up played pretty well.
Yeah, that's the way it has to go. Yeah. You know, there's going to be 11 guys out there, and we don't have any control over that as coaches. It might be an injury or something along those lines, and so we're going to coach who's available, who's out there, and try and do our best to put them in position to be successful. And was just happy to see, like I said, in the long run, a game like Saturday will help us. You know, a guy like Clifford Amazan, Terry Thomas, those guys that got more reps, Martarius Allen's gotten a lot of reps the last two games. So in the long run, we'll have a lot more depth up front, due to some other guys' injuries.
Let's talk a little bit about the linebackers, you know, at the risk of bringing it up again. You know, you got used to having Joe Peterson back there, loaded at linebacker. You got guys like McGee and Ringer, Trey Payne, who's back.
Mm-hmm.
Chase Middleton stepped up big. He had 15 tackles out at Air Force. Mm-hmm. I mean, right behind that defensive line, the Panthers are solid.
Yeah, those guys, it was good to have Trey back, and that's the style of game that Trey's built for. It's kind of a downhill in between the tackles running game. So it was very, very good to get him back. Alonzo McGee, you know, moved into the will spot that Joe P used to play. So I think he's having a very productive year. And then, you know, we got to keep playing a lot of guys there. We got to play Ringer a lot. We got to play Chase a lot. Charlie Patrick had started to play some, and then he got hurt and missed the last game. But that's a position. We need to roll guys. We need to stay fresh. One, because we have played a lot of plays, we need to make sure we continue to roll guys in at those positions.
Bobby Baker had an outstanding game as well. He and Alonzo McGee led the way with 11 tackles. He had one of the two takeaways. Chandon Sullivan ends up with an interception. Bobby with a fumble recovery. Panthers didn't turn the ball over at all. Defense came away with two.
Yeah, you know, like I said, in those type of games, you know, they have the ball third and goal on the one. Zoe comes in and makes a great play on the running back, kind of gets his hand on the ball. Ball pops up, and Bobby was kind of playing the back safety, saw the ball come out, and was quick to get on it. So just a great opportunity for us to keep him out of the end zone or even from getting a field goal. And then later in the game, you know, we had just scored to get it within 13-10, mm-hmm. And we go out and get a pick. So that was a big play by Chandon, and you know, those corners continue to play well for us, and hopefully we'll get more and more as the season goes on.
Before we get to questions with Coach Minter this week, I assume that the off week comes at a pretty good time, especially as the defensive coordinator, because we mentioned you played at Wisconsin without what, three or four starters. Hopefully you can get most, if not all, those guys
back.
Yeah,
I think it's at a great time for us. One, we're getting ready for conference play, get a chance to get McKendy, Shawanye, Andrew, you know, those Carnell, all those bodies back that have been really good players for us. So it's a chance to fix some things that we need to fix, take our breath a little bit this upcoming weekend and get everybody ready to roll for App State.
All right, time now for questions for the defensive coordinator for the Georgia State football team, Coach Jesse Minter.
This is Montana White Street Watch Radio. Coach Minter, I want to know what a nickel defense is and when do you use it?
Nickel defense for us is five defensive backs, so we bring in a third corner. It's a lot of times used against spread offenses where they have three and or four receivers on the field. So it's a chance for us to take a linebacker-type body off the field, bring in a defensive back, and sort of match up more from an athleticism standpoint.
Hey, this is Grace. I'm currently studying film at Georgia State University. Coach Minter, what is your favorite Coach Miles story?
Well, I have quite a few. Some may or not be good enough for the air, but my favorite since we've been here is probably, you know, one day a couple years ago, he suited up, and all of a sudden, I didn't even realize it, but I'm out there running practice with the defense, and we're in our scout team periods where we're trying to get ready for our next opponent, and Coach Miles has full gear on, and he's out there running routes for us as a scout team wide receiver. Probably the funniest part about the story is how much he hurt the next day. And it kind of made everybody realize what our players go through on a day-to-day basis and put it in perspective for us as coaches, kind of the daily grind that those guys go through. But that was a good lighthearted moment for the players and for Coach, and was just a good deal all around.
Hey, Coach Minter, my name is Monish, and I'm a chem major here at Georgia State University. And my question is, who is your favorite superhero and why?
My favorite superhero? I would probably say Superman, only because he's a regular guy doing regular things, and all of a sudden when he's called upon, he can take the suit off, put the superhero costume on, and go do special things. And that to me is what you look for in special people, and hopefully a lot of our players can play like that this upcoming game.
All right, Coach, good questions this week. And I was out there that morning. I remember I'm out in the field. I'm looking for Coach. I couldn't find him. It took me a little while to kind of zero in on him with the helmet on and the jersey. That was an interesting practice.
Yeah, he, you know, had a lot of fun with it. I think the players had fun. Our corners at the time didn't know whether to tackle him or make sure they stay off of him. But it was a good moment.
All right, appreciate you coming in, and enjoy the off week, and we'll see you up in Boone.
Sounds good. Look forward to it.
All right, I want to thank Georgia State's defensive coordinator, Jesse Minter, joining us here on the Georgia State Sports Update. Here's what's coming up this week on the schedule at Georgia State. Athletically, Friday, September 23rd at 7 p.m., women's soccer hosting the Chanticleers of Coastal Carolina. That'll be out at the GSU Soccer Complex. And then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, September 23, 24, and 25, men's and women's tennis competing in the Southern Intercollegiate Championship over in Athens. And pleased to be joined in studio right now by defensive end McKendy Cherador. And McKendie, great to have you here with us for a guy who's been on the injured list the last couple of weeks. I know you're glad to be back. I know you were with us at Wisconsin, but couldn't get on the field. You're back just in time to get ready for Sun Belt Conference play. Tell me a little bit about what the injury was and how the rehab's gone and how happy you are to be back.
You know, it was a high ankle sprain, and it was really a tough injury because I weigh a lot, so it was tough getting back from it. And you know, watching on the sideline practice, it makes me cherish the moments I'm out there with my brothers, and I'm really happy to be back on my birthday.
I was going to say, how difficult was that at Wisconsin in that kind of a game, the way the defense was playing, the way the team was playing, to not be able to be out there?
It was very difficult, but at the same time, I was really proud of those guys out there because they was fighting hard and showed a lot of effort every play, and that's what kind of defense we can play.
Well, you know, as Coach Minter said, some of the younger guys had to step up and play because not only were you not available at your spot, Shawanye Lawrence was not available at his spot. Andrew Everett, who's a relative newcomer but an upperclassman, not available at his spot. Carnell Hobson was not available because of injury. The guys playing behind you did what they had to do, and they stepped up. But, you know, that's a little bit of a leadership role for you and the rest of the upperclassmen to bring those guys along. You guys did a great job with them.
Definitely, we did. In our defensive line room, he tries to teach us the next man up type theory.
Right.
So when one man goes down, the next person has to be ready to step up and play well. And that's what Terry Thomas and Clifford did for us.
You know, you look a lot bigger than you did last year. Well, I say a lot. A lot of hard work during the offseason coming out of the bowl game. And talk a little bit about the hard work that goes in during the offseason. Fans, they see week to week. They see game to game. They don't see all the work that goes on out there at Auburn, at ML King, where the practice facility is, the amount of time that you guys spend out there getting ready and the work that you do with Coach Holsapple.
You know, it's really a grind. It's like, it's basically having a job, kind of. But we work hard every single day, and we starting to get into the mode where just doing stuff in the morning with Coach Sop is not enough. So we do extra stuff in the afternoon, then we come back the next morning and do more and more and more. We just have a grind, and we have a chip on our shoulder, and it's really a lot of hard work put into it.
I was going to say, sometimes it seems like you do a lot of work, and then there's a little part of you that says, man, I need to do a little more. Do you ever feel like it's ever enough, preparation-wise?
Never.
Never?
Never.
Again, we're talking to McKendie Cheridor, and you're an economics major here at Georgia State, so you've had to learn over the years that you've been here to balance all of this time that you're putting in over at the practice facility with the academic side of being a student athlete.
Yes, you know, being an econ major is really a lot of work, and I didn't realize that until I got into my upper classes. And I have a minor also in hospitality, so that's just more work. But I did a good job learning how to balance both out and getting my work done in class and coming on the field and practice and play games too.
Well, McKendie, it's great to have you back. And going with us to Boone, and it's great to have you here in the studio, and best of luck the rest of the year.
Appreciate you.
All right, I want to thank McKendie Cheridor coming in and joining us. Again, thanks to our other guests, the defensive coordinator Jesse Minter, as well as the men's head soccer coach Brett Cerency. For the entire crew, we'll see you here next week on the Georgia State Sports Update.